I should. So we're going to hold off on my recommendation, hold off on the chair and vice chair. It's not maybe not necessary to even have one, but certainly tonight let's learn about the roles of the RAC committee, and we can go from there. I will say we wanted to get a meeting here before Christmas. It could easily be January or February before we have another meeting. I mean, there's just things that the Treasury asked of Dewberry and of the county that we have to get resolved and in place before we move too much further. So there may be a gap of 6 weeks or so before there's another meeting. But with that, I'll turn it over to Stella, and Stella is with Dewberry Consultants, and she'll introduce her staff, and I'll let her go from here.
All right. Thank you, Alan. I'm going to try to talk towards the board members here and the audience, so if anybody can't hear me, just let me know, and I'll talk way louder. We do intend to have a projector at the next meeting so everybody can see the set of slides that we prepared up on the wall here. We had a bit of an issue with it this time, but next time we'll have one so everybody can see. But you all should have a handout here. And for everybody that did not get a handout for tonight's meeting, this will be posted on the website. There's a website. It is www.franklincountyrestore.com.
And it's linked to the county's general website.
Yes, if you go to Franklin County's general website, there's a link on the left that says Franklin County Restore. If you click that link, it will also take you to the website. I'm going to jump around a little bit, but just to give you a little bit more details about the website, it will have the agendas posted before the meeting. We will also email you all and let you know that the agenda has been posted. It should have the presentations. This one should be up by tonight. And then it will also have the minutes from the meeting. It will have any important documents that you all have reviewed or adopted. It will have notices of meetings. It will have the calendar of the meetings. So anything and everything that you would want to know about this MYIP process should be posted on that website, including contact information for myself as well. Okay. So just to kind of go through what we want to kind of talk about tonight, first of all, I'm Stella Wilson. I'm with Dewberry, and as Alan said, the County Commission did hire Dewberry to sort of help set up this framework for the MYIP process. This is going to be about an 18-month process, and as Alan said, that 18 months of work will really be setting up the framework for how the county chooses projects and ultimately which projects they will fund. And the way that we'll set it up, because it is taking 18 months, is it should be repeatable every year. As Alan said, the first round of this, you're only allowed to access the year one funds, but hopefully the way that we set it up in the end, it will be repeatable every year again, so it won't have to be the same 18-month process every single time, because that wouldn't make a whole lot of sense. Connie Lasher is also with Dewberry, and I'm in the Pensacola office. Connie's also in the Pensacola office. And then we also have on our team Jade Marks. She's in the Tallahassee Office for Ecology and Environment. They are part of the Dewberry's team on this process. And then we also have Paul Johnson, who is in the Tallahassee Office for Ecology and Environment. So the four folks that you see here is who you'll be seeing the most of, especially at the meetings and coordinating on the website, you know, if there's something there that we need to post. There's a couple of other names here on your handout on page 3. And we also have Brian Griffith. He's come to a couple of the commission meetings. You'll see.
Extension Director.
And I'm Brenda LaPaz, Mayor of City of Carabel, representing Carabel.
Otis Amson, I'm representing the seafood industry. I'm from Apalachicola.
Van Johnson, representing the City of Apalachicola.
Thank you very much. Yeah, good idea, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that's okay. All right, so I'm on page 4, and we kind of wanted to talk a little bit about you all's role. I'm sure you're curious as to what exactly is going to be expected of you sitting up there, you know, what kinds of things you're going to have to vote on, what kinds of things you're going to have to talk about, and where really you all plug in to the overall process. So that's kind of some of the things we'll be talking about tonight. We don't have anything planned to take any voting or action tonight unless you all choose to, but we don't have anything planned for tonight. As Alan said, there are 7 members total. One of the members has not been appointed yet, so at some point, probably in the near future, you will all be having a 7th member. October 20th, in case you want to see the agenda packet or minutes, is the date that the County Commission reformalized this committee. October 20th of this year.
Okay, let me just say, because some of y'all were on the previous committee, and what happened was we realize that as other counties move forward, that they have reformed their committees and made them smaller and more able to have easier have a quorum met. And it also just streamlined the process where when the committee got so large, first of all, you begin to feel like people, if they weren't on the committee, they were left out, so we're having some inner squabbles in the committee. So we made a committee, we think a very powerful committee representing people who really know the committee and the community they live in and can well represent the communities they live in and the areas that they serve. And that then frees up other people to be more active as lobbyists and activists for projects. Because there is a little bit of a challenge for you all as committee members, and Eric is principally the struggle with this, or the mayors will have the same problem, that when we get down to creating criteria, you really can't lobby for that project because you're a member of the committee here. Now, you certainly have projects in the pipeline, but it's a balancing act there is how that goes. We'll just have to see how it works out. But we think I have a great committee, but we shrunk it down to make it more manageable and to function a little more efficiently than what we previously had structured. And other counties have done the same thing, so we sort of follow along.
Exactly. Mr. Schuler, and then collectively we can give you all some guidance if you think that you have a voting conflict. All right, so I'm going to move on here to page 5. We covered the meetings, obviously contributing to the discussions, providing feedback. More or less, when I get into the overview of what sort of the process is that we've kind of laid out for the next few months, then you'll kind of see where you all plug in, where everything about the process will be facilitated through this committee. So there won't really be any decisions or any process changes that don't come here to this committee first. So we'll be looking to you all for all of that guidance. We have listed some key decision points here, the needs assessment, selection criteria, project priorities, and then the ultimate document itself that goes to the Treasury. So we will get into that in just a second. Do stop me if you have any questions, because I'm just going to probably keep on rambling, and then I'll stop and see if there are more questions.
Yeah, the key thing I'll just say, because we're doing it, is that we ultimately will produce what's called an MYIP, a multi-year implementation plan. That's what Treasury wants to see. There's a process that Treasury is making us go through to get that. But that's really what your role is, to assist the community in developing an MYIP. Every county has to have one. You can't get any funds until your MYIP is adopted and approved by the Treasury. So that's the process we have to go through.
So I'm going to kind of back up all the way almost to the beginning. I'm not going to give you all a whole, this is what Restore does. I'm only going to trickle down to this particular component. But on page 6, you have this graphic that kind of shows you where the money is flowing. This is a little bit different because this oil spill, the Clean Water Act fines, it was negotiated that a portion of these fines would go directly back to the communities that were impacted instead of staying at the Fed level and then that money just being distributed to different agencies. So the direct component, as we refer to as pot one, that's the pot where the MYIP must be created for the individual counties. I list a few of the requirements here. It's actually a little bit more extensive than this. The Treasury Department has, I want to say, about 4 or 5 documents on their website. If you go to treasury.gov/restore, that are guidance documents that tells you exactly what they're looking for as far as this MYIP document and what the requirements of that document are. So, like I said, I just listed a couple of here. There are, and we'll go through them one by one, I think.
Excuse me, what was that website again?
It's treasury.gov/restore.
Thank
you. You're welcome. And, let's see. So on page 7, we mentioned eligible activities. For the direct components, any project priorities that you all consider or discuss, they do have to be consistent with one of these 11 activities that are listed in the Restore Act. This is on page 7. This is also on the treasury.gov/restore's website, and this is word for word out of the Restore Act. So, we've had a couple of questions. Can the direct component money pay for this? Can it pay for that? And there really are 3 tiers of eligibility. That's it has to meet one of these eligible activities. Then the money, the actual costs, have to go towards activities that meet these eligible activities. And then obviously you have to be an eligible entity, which the county is. But if the county were to choose to go into an agreement with any other entity to actually procure the project and implement the project, then that entity also has to be eligible per the federal guidelines. And that is the bullet reference that's listed on page 6 is the last one we have here, the 2 CFR 200. That's the OMB circular. I want to say it's about 600 or 700 pages, but it's the general federal guidance as to what dollars can be spent where and which activities.
I'm kind of curious about the car. So the county gets the money, and we go through all this process. We list the project. I'm going to use Dan as an example. Dan, and the Riverkeeper submits a project. We think it's great, and it's a $1 million project for something Riverkeeper wants to do. The money would never go to the Riverkeeper Center. The $1 million would come to the county, and we would administer the project that they had designed and created.
That is correct. If you needed to procure out design or construction, then you would have to procure that in the way that's consistent with the federal government procurement guidelines.
Okay.
So you can do that. If you wanted to come up with some agreement where you thought that the Riverkeepers did have the capacity to implement this project, then you would have to go through a whole process where you more or less prove to the federal government that this organization does have the capacity to implement the project. And there are a pretty long list of requirements for that. So I won't say it's impossible, but in most cases it's not probable. If an organization doesn't already have federal grant experience, it takes a pretty good amount of effort and time and money to get to the point where they would be. But the county could choose, if you had an instrument such as a cooperative agreement, typically that's going to be with another municipality or something like that, but it would be really difficult to go that route. Definitely is an option, but a difficult route.
I want to ask a question, Dan, and the mayor's been thinking this. All right, so let's say the cities want to do infrastructure work in the cities. You know, it's logical the cities do it. I mean, why don't the county want to handle money for expanding sewer systems? And why would
in the case of the cities, since municipalities typically already have at least some experience with any, the thing that the Treasury is most concerned about is being able to prove that the organization has the financial organizational capacity, and most cities are going to be able to prove that because they have a finance department, they have an accounting structure, they have, you know, a sort of CEO set up with a city manager typically. So they usually have the structure and the capacity to be able to prove that. It's still a process, but it would be a lot easier with municipalities. All right, so moving on to page 8 then, this one just shows what the allocations are for Franklin County, the totals. Transocean, as we stated, is a total of $3.563 million, and that is money that is already in the bank and allocated to Franklin County. Those funds can be accessed as soon as the MYIP is developed, submitted, approved by Treasury, and the county submits individual grant applications for those projects. So we'll talk about the time frame for that in just a second here. The total BP settlement, as you probably heard, the BP settlement was finalized in July of this year. So that comes out to an additional $19.48 million in addition to the $3.563 million allocated from Transocean. So then that's a total of $23.044 million. And as it says, current allocations available are 3.563. So really, we want to highlight that 3.563 million number because that is the plan that you will be coming up with first. And more or less, how the county plans to spend that money first.
And this, again, the nice thing about that number is you all are advisory, because the challenge is going to be the community, not just the community, but every community is all these big numbers, you know, millions of dollars coming forward. And so, as I told the people, it's really an issue for all of us here in this room to manage our expectations. I mean, we would love to award, and also will award $23 million for the project, but guess what? U.S. Treasury says you only have $3.5 million right now, so don't talk about a $10 million project because you're not going to get awarded a $10 million project. So it's going to be a challenge for all of us to scale things down so that we can get something through the system, because I wish we were in control. We're not. We have a portal to go through the U.S. Treasury, but they ultimately will say, yes, this is something you can do or not. So I just encourage y'all to think. I wish the sky was as $23 million right now, but it's not. You know, we hope to get this done, and we hope to get things on the ground and improvements in people's lives. And that right now, that window was $3.5 million, not $23 million.
So on page 9, we have a graphic here that says multi-year implementation plan process, and this sort of lays out the framework for the plans that we've been carrying out in the other counties, and we discussed this with Alan and the county staff and submitted this to the commission, and they felt like this was a good plan. So this is generally the track that we're going to take. It hits all the marks that Treasury requires us to hit. So just kind of going through these one by one, and on the next page there's a general schedule. Number one, engineer the MYIP framework. That's kind of a fancy name for just saying that we're going to conduct a community needs assessment. So today's meeting is really about, like we said, just letting you all know what the process is, getting to know each other, seeing if you have any questions right off the bat, and then talking about the schedule and the process. The very next step is conducting this community needs assessment. We've kind of already started on this, and so what we'll do at your very next meeting is we will present to you more or less a matrix of what we feel the issues are in the community, pretty much your critical issues. Like Alan said, definitely not going to be able to solve every single county, you know, issue or problem in the county with the money that's there, but we definitely want to identify the critical issues and see if we can tackle those. So, like I said, we've already started on that work, and so at your next meeting, before the meeting, we will send you a document via email and post it on the website, basically a draft, and it'll be just sort of a list of what the critical issues are in the community, and then we'll definitely ask for your feedback, whether or not you think that those are correct issues, if we missed some, and then we'll have a discussion about it, and then we'll get to the point where we finalize that list, and that list will help inform the next step. So we'll probably have two of these meetings on that particular step, just to make sure we get to the point where everybody's comfortable with the needs of the community, and it's meant to be a comprehensive list, so it can be pretty long. I think in Gulf County, you know, they probably had 3 pages of issues. So, and then basically what the next step is, it says developing the selection criteria. It's more or less a prioritization of those critical issues in the county. So, for example, oyster restoration, that might be something that you identify in the first step, and you might also identify, you know, maybe leaky septic tanks or something as another issue. And then in the second step, you would want to take that comprehensive list of all the critical issues and then sort of prioritize them. And what we'll basically do is assign points to them. So, you know, if oyster restoration is what the committee feels is the most important thing through the public input that you get and through your experience in the community, then that issue might get 10 points, whereas another issue might get 4 points. And so what that does is it sets it up for step three. Step three is where we basically ask the community to provide us project ideas, and they will have to be pretty comprehensive in nature, and right now we're still kind of finalizing what some of those rules might be with Treasury, whether or not we can open it up to the general public, or if it should be received only from organizations that have a, you know, a financial status with the IRS, like NGOs. But during that step, folks will then submit projects to this online web-based portal. We do have a paper process as well. We have a paper application if they don't have computer access. But those projects will then be scored based on the criteria that you all developed in the step before that. So it's a pretty comprehensive, holistic approach, and it's meant to really be very fair and really get to the issues. Basically, you're identifying all the problems, and then the projects are meant to be proposed solutions to those problems, and then your criteria is supposed to set it up where the solutions that are going to work the best are the projects that are going to rank the highest. Yes, ma'am.
Just one question. Mm-hmm. Will we have pre-proposals, or it will be the final proposal for each project?
It's something that we still can discuss. As we get a little bit closer to that process, we can discuss that a little bit more. We've seen the pre-proposal process play out in some counties and then not in others. It sort of just depends. A couple of them definitely do have the two-tiered steps. I think it depends on how much information you want to get from the organizations, because a lot of folks obviously will take their stab at it, and then it's easy to criticize, right? So we can always come back and say, you missed this, this, and this. And then you could give them another chance to fill those gaps in.
Perhaps pre-proposals would not be necessary because of the size of the county. Maybe we will not have, you know, just an influx.
Yeah, that's sort of the kind of question we're a little ahead again. But this is a good group. Y'all are very familiar with the community. One of the challenges we may have, and I don't see it happening tonight, is that we have a group coming from out of the county, you know, recognize that Frank Payne's got to have this money, and that, hey, we want to see things done that would have a benefit in your community. I'm just making this up. Let's say somebody recognizes that there's a drainage issue in Liberty County that, you know, gee whiz, if you all would fix that, you'll have a better oyster crop. Well, those are the kind of things we just kind of have to scale out, because, you know, we really want to see improvements in Franklin County. This is our one shot of money that we've never had before, and we just want to make sure we do the best we can. The other thing that's important
and Dewberry haven't said this yet here, but they said it at the county commission meeting, is that one of the things that we would like to see accomplished, and it's going to be hard for people who are not as knowledgeable as other groups to benefit from this, but we really want to leverage this money. I mean, this restore money is something that we may never see again in our lifetime, and we want to get as much done as possible. And the unique thing about the restore money is it is considered free money in the sense that we can use that as matching money for other grant programs out there. So if there's a project that we want to see accomplished, and we know, and I'm using the cities because they're the obvious ones as an example, the cities are eligible to get money from some other funding source, then that's going to score probably higher, because guess what? We're going to be able to match that money and do more because we have another funding source. And so that's something that Dewberry promoted very strongly at the county commission level, that look, you know, they will consider themselves successful if we take the $23 million and turn it into $50 million worth of improvements in the community. And the only way you do that is to leverage the money with other programs that are out there. And so it will take, you know, it's not, I don't necessarily consider our obligation, your all's obligation, to find that other money. That's the recipient's obligation. They're going to say, hey, man, we got a great project, and we know there's a funding source out there. And, you know, that's their job, is to put those pieces together.
So leveraging could be a part of the application under the scoring.
It could. It could. In fact, it's a really good example. Gulf County, they chose to have leveraging as part of their scoring criteria. It was one of the highest that you could get, almost up to 18 points on it. And when their project submission portal closed, they had a total restore direct component request from the county, total combined projects of every single project submitted of $23 million, but the matching ratio that they brought with it brought the project totals up to $76 million. So they had over a 3.0 multiplier on their leveraging. I think, you know, a lot of the credit maybe there is due to Mr. Yeager and his efforts, but I think the way that they set up that structure was really, really good, and it really encouraged the organizations. I mean, the port, for example, they submitted an application for $600,000 instead of $40 million, and they said they'd bring the other $40 million with them. So it was really incredible to see the leveraging work out like that so far.
Yeah, because we've got a delivery. You all know, so I shouldn't have to say, I don't have to say this, but I mean, it creates more jobs in the community, it just more benefits, so the more we can leverage the money, it's just, you know, this is an opportunity to do things that we couldn't do, and so I think leveraging is going to be an important factor for us also.
Would Mr. Pierce review the applications, I guess that's what you're, the proposals, the documents before they come before this committee, as him being the director, I guess?
Not necessarily.
To make sure that all of the questions, all of the criteria.
Sure, I want to make sure applications are completed so people have, everybody has a fair chance. I can do that. Well, as far as any sort of vetting, no, I wouldn't be doing that.
Yeah, we'll do a complete comprehensive review of every single application. In step four here that you have on this list, it says assistant, advise, and rankings. Mm-hmm. We'll do an eligibility review. We'll do a technical and feasibility analysis. We'll do the environmental assessments, and then we'll do the scoring as well. Go ahead.
Of each submittal before it comes to the committee?
Correct.
Okay.
So we'll have a little hiatus in how long you all meet when the projects come in. The Dewberry team, ecology and environment, they'll be experts in the environmental categories and the infrastructure categories. We'll do some of the baseline criteria at Dewberry, and then the UWF Haas Center will do all of the scoring in the economic categories. And once all of those reviews are done and we have proposed scores for you, we will then bring that here for you to discuss.
One of the challenges for the groups who are going to be for their projects is that even though everything's been, the federal law has been in existence a long time, this is being reviewed at the federal level. So, environmental project. Let's say we want to rebuild some wetlands. We have to make sure to comply with all the federal standards for wetland mitigation. And you know, we at the local level haven't always had to do that because we haven't been operating with federal involvement. So there's going to be a challenge in some of these projects where the details and the amount of reporting and just data collection is going to be higher level than we normally see here. And that's going to be a challenge. People may get angry at that, I'll be honest with you. So they're going to say, we not done it before? Well, yes, guess what? We never directly dealt with the U.S. Treasury before and all the rules and regulations that they have at the federal level. And that's going to be a big hurdle, I think, for some of the groups who are wanting to see things done. You know, they may be overwhelmed and somewhat frustrated with the amount of reporting that's necessary to comply with the rules.
I have a question, then it goes back to the very beginning. you talked about some organizations may not be able to manage the funds themselves, and then that would be encumbered upon the county to do that. So that would, that's going to be.
Right, that's a problem we have to get addressed. Yes, that's correct. Now, the Treasury has set aside some administrative money, so there will be a way for the county to do that without the burden of the taxpayers. We haven't worked through all that yet.
Escambia County, they started developing their MYIP in July of 2014, and they still haven't answered that question. They still haven't answered the question of who will actually be implementing these projects. They say it'll be a mix, you know, and it'll actually come down to this individual specific projects. If it's a workforce project, for example, that maybe one of the local universities or schools propose, then it could be that the county enters into a cooperative agreement with the university because they do have a lot of federal grant management experience, and then that university actually will implement the program. If it was an organization that's really small, like in Escambia County, there is a River Keepers, but they're a little bit smaller, and I think they do have some experience, but they don't have a huge, you know, full-time financial department staff. So in that case, the county, if they chose that project, most likely would implement that project themselves.
Who develops these cooperative agreements? Would it be the county attorney or Dewberry Associates?
It would definitely have to be a county-driven process. Mm-hmm. And they would have to be reviewed by the county attorney, I'm sure, and adopted by the commissioners, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but unfortunately, the way the federal legislation is written at this time, only the eight counties in the Panhandle are part of the direct component, so only eight counties can receive the money. So we would then, if we want to work with other communities, which we do, we would have to enter into partnerships. I think the county would initiate that.
Mm-hmm.
By the time, because we're a little bit behind and we're also small, we're going to take advantage of what has been done by other counties. And so we'll see some of the templates and some of the structures, some of the agreements that other people are doing. So I hopefully we'll have to recreate the wheel anyway.
Should be a pretty standard contract agreement, just with the language in it that you need, developed and reviewed by attorneys, as you said.
But what is frustrating for us so far, and we've only just begun with the U.S. Treasury, is that I'll say this way: U.S. Treasury, I don't think really wanted to be in this role. They didn't really want to be, managing projects, and so because they don't want to be accused of mismanagement, they're auditors
by nature,
and they really were unhappy with the role they got selected. So they're like, all right, you want us to follow it? We're going to follow it to the T. Because there have been accusations of other big federal programs of mismanagement, the money being improperly spent, and by God, U.S. Treasury says on our watch that's not going to happen. So they have really set the bar pretty high for complying with the rules in order to get access to the money. And it's just going to be a bit of a challenge for everybody.
It's such a small amount of money. A good bit of it's going to have to go to documentation,
yes,
paperwork,
yes,
attorneys,
yes,
engineers, accounting.
Right, and project people who are developing projects need to be aware of that, because somebody's going to do that. Maybe it's volunteers, but most likely it's not. So we're going to get paid to do that stuff.
And like Alan said, the Treasury does allow, well, they've amended this figure a bit, but the Restore Act allows up to 10% in administrative costs. Treasury is really not allowing more than about 3% right now, but there is a little bit of wiggle room there for the county to, in the future, have those administrative costs and project management costs so they can take care of all this paperwork. And then the next 18 months, as we submit the MYIP and the MYIP itself, which is the last step, so once we, once you all agree on a slate of projects that you would like to recommend to the commission for year one, then that will go to the county commission, and the county commission will ultimately approve a list of projects for year one. Once they do that, everything that we've done for the past 18 months to that point, all of these meetings, all of the minutes, all of the discussions, all of the decision points, all of the documents, all of the documentation, such as the newspaper ad, things like this where we noticed today's meeting, all of this documentation, Dewberry and E&E are keeping track of this, and we will all submit it to the U.S. Treasury as part of this documentation at the end of the process. So they'll have all that nice and organized for them. So that would be the last step, and then ultimately the goal is to get that document approved by Treasury so that the county can start its grant applications. And on the next page here, on page 10, we just kind of talk about the schedule of how long we think that might take. Right now we're thinking about 18 months. That's been about the typical schedule with the other counties to kind of go through this whole entire process, and that'll give everybody plenty of time to have the discussions that need to be had and to have the public input that needs to be had, so that the decisions that are being made and the recommendations that are being made are very well informed. So we're your consultants. We're here to help you and guide you every single step of the way. But, you know, personally, I grew up in Pensacola and Milton, so I don't get around this way too much. So you all, having lived here pretty much your whole lives, and the community input is extremely, extremely important, because we definitely don't want to be here trying to, you know, help you make every single decision. We're just kind of here as guidance. So as far as the schedule goes.
Well, however, but I mean, you all's role as a committee, you're really only acting when you sit as a committee, so you may be peppered with questions, you know, outside in your general life, but your role is here, and we hope to have these meetings, you know, no more than once a month or so. We hope to have an 18-month period, have 18 meetings. So we hope this not to be an overburden for you all. The meetings are going to mostly have to be in the evening to meet public notice requirements. So I hope this is not a tremendous burden on you all. You know, we look at 18 months, but we look at really 18 to 20 meetings, and that will, you know, then your role is done. Once we get the plan adopted, your role is done.
Well, this is, we're talking about year one.
Yeah.
And this is a 15-year pot of money. So you're going to have a committee convened every year for 15 years?
You don't necessarily have to have a committee for every single year. There still needs to be a public involvement process of some sort every single year.
So we...
In the subsequent years, there is a bare minimum that wouldn't necessarily require a committee at all.
The county commission could receive public comment.
Yes.
It's possible you all will create a plan that covers the 15-year period.
Yes.
You know, and with projects in sequence in that 15-year period. And so as year two, the county commission holds a public hearing, and, you know, if things haven't changed enough, we just submit the projects and we've already identified for year two and go through there. Admittedly, at some point, you know, 5 or 6 years down the way, the community may have changed and priorities may have changed. And so there may have to be a restructuring. But I hope your all's roles and your appointments are for to complete, you know, the MYIP in really year one. You know, so we're not trying to tie you into a lifetime.
I won't be here that
long. And that's a really good point, because although we say that this MYIP is only for the year one funds, it's a really, really good opportunity to set this document up to be a planning framework for the entire future, really the entire 15 years. And really, it can be a little bit more comprehensive than that. It doesn't even necessarily, I mean, Treasury is looking for which projects are you going to fund, tell me if they're eligible, okay, thank you very much. You had your public involvement, let me check to make sure you did all that, thank you very much. But beyond that, this is still an opportunity for Franklin County to use that document as a more or less a federally approved planning, you know, document. It makes it a little bit easier in the future, and when we talk about leveraging to apply for other grants through other agencies such as NOAA, for you to be able to point back to, yes, we went through a whole process. We had meetings with the public, and we decided that these are our priorities, and we still need funding. We have Restore, but we still need funding for X. And then you can always point to that document and say, you know, this is all the discussions we have, this is the conclusion that we came up with, and this document says that this county needs X. And once Treasury approves it, it becomes a federally approved plan, which is great for applying for future grants.
So it's possible, I said, without any idea in mind of scenario, but it's possible where we would have projects that look really good, but we say, this is a great project, but in our goal to expand and extend Restore money as far as possible. Project A, you are not going to get funded until you show up with a match. And I don't know if that's possible or not, but, you know, put the incentive on these groups who want to get things done, find some of that match. You know, we'll put you in the pipeline, but, you know, we'll skip over you until you get your match. I don't know if that's going to be able to feasible or not.
Absolutely.
So if there's a project or a proposal that's not in this plan, then it can't be approved. Is that correct?
There are amendments allowed to the document. Mm-hmm. Every year you can do an amendment to the document.
But I guess it would be best to try to make it comprehensive and get as many project ideas or proposals into it. And I understand it would be amended or like a living document. Everything that's in there is not necessarily going to be approved, but just comprehensive.
Priorities might change.
Yes. Exactly.
Something important might come up.
Yeah, you may lay out a specific plan in the MYIP, and for year one, that's pretty static as far as Treasury goes. If you amend anything substantial, you do have to go through the public review. And the bare minimum on the amendment is the 45-day public notice and comment period. So if you make any amendments, you know, this is our MYIP. If we strike anything out, add anything, delete anything, we need to put that out to the public for at least 45 days, try to solicit some feedback and some comments, address those comments, make sure everybody's happy with it, and then send it back to Treasury with the process of the, you know, the 45-day public review and comment period. But like you said, that's definitely the plan, is to set out the framework in this first 18 months, because that's a lot of work already. So in the next years after that, the idea is that it's a much, much simpler process to just amend or tweak what you need to tweak.
I mean, I really hope that it's for the first 5 years, you know, that we really wouldn't have to have it, you know, that we would have to do a good enough job, that we know what our priorities are. The community doesn't change that fast. Mm-hmm. That, you know, for the first series, that we would be pretty well lined up just as money comes available when we move down to this project.
And that seems like it's going to be pretty viable. Probably more or less, it seems like most of the counties have a pretty good five-year plan. And then, like Alan said, usually most communities don't change significantly within 5 years, but you may have a shift, and so you are allowed to amend it. But it seems like it might be about every 5 years that you may have a major change. Okay. As far as the schedule goes, we did want to have, like I said, this meeting tonight just to familiarize everybody with the process, get to know everybody, have the public come so they can get some information on the website and where to get the notices. Those will be published in the Apalachicola Times. And we have the next meeting, it's on page 11, tentatively scheduled for, and I know I said mark your calendars, but we may have a change and we will get with you on that. But we have the next meeting tentatively scheduled for January 19th. Like Alan said, we are actually currently waiting on Treasury to respond to a couple of issues that we're discussing with them right now, which actually may delay what your first step is and when that starts. So we'll definitely keep you informed. Hopefully we'll have a meeting no later than February 2nd, but we will keep you informed as to whether that January 19th meeting will happen or if it will be moved to February 2nd.
And although I don't know this guy, I'm looking at the calendar, we're looking at all these are on Tuesday nights?
These are all on Tuesday nights, yes. I think we said the 2nd, or was it right. The 2nd or the 4th? Sorry, what's today, the 15th?
Today's the 4th.
I believe these are the 2nd Tuesdays, is okay. What we were trying to shoot for. Now, there are some that have two meetings in the same month. Well, maybe I didn't do that to y'all. I think that's
the
county
third,
commission.
January 19th is probably the 3rd Tuesday.
It is a 3rd.
Yeah, and we have an April 5th in here, so no, they're not always the 2nd Tuesday.
But they're on Tuesdays.
There are Tuesdays at 5 o'clock. And then you can see just the tasks going down here. We have a meeting in March, April. There are certain points in time where we would like to check back with the County Commission and make sure that we're on track and doing what they expected and coming up with, you know, the process steps as far as they expected. So sometime in April, we will be checking back with them to let them know what the progress has been and to make sure we're on track. And then we'll have, in addition to your regular meetings like this, we'll probably have a couple of just public workshops where we have more of a roundtable discussion with the members of the general public that come, so they can just have input and general discussion. That's usually pretty productive as far as getting some words on a document. So those are scheduled for, I believe, May and June. Another reason for those workshops in May and June is if we plan to open the web portal as we do now in May through July, then we really want the public to have an opportunity to go to those meetings, and we walk through the process step by step at both of those meetings so they completely, you know, understand where to go, how to do it, and what the criteria are.
And so my open portal is when people begin submitting grant applications?
Project applications, yeah. Exactly.
So the meeting's going to start at 5?
Yes, we try to.
And it's going to last about an hour?
We hope so. We fail task.
Well, that February meeting is a city commission meeting.
Okay.
February 2nd?
Okay.
You want to talk about that later, change that later?
Yeah, let's see, because all that whole set may be moved back depending on how we get not public exactly. Forever. So we appreciate that. February 2nd is a city commission meeting.
Yeah, this is flexible. The only thing we did try to avoid was the county commission meetings, obviously, since they share the same room as you all. So if you do have conflicts, then we can definitely see about amending the dates, and we'll provide plenty of notice if those are changed. So just get with Alan on that. Other notable things, target submittal date to Treasury. Again, this is a pretty lengthy process. We're looking at February of 2017. And then once we submit it to them, they have 30 to 60 days to review and approve it. So we're looking at approval sometime in April of 2017. Once the MYIP is approved by Treasury, the county has to prepare individual grant applications for the specific projects that are outlined in the MYIP. The MYIP, sorry, it stands for Multi-Year Implementation Plan. So that document is just a plan, and then the grant applications follow, and those have more of the details in them. So even though the MYIP is taking approximately 18 months to put together and submit, we're hearing that the individual grant applications are taking some time as well, up to 6 months, to review and approve by Treasury.
So now you say.
Well, I'm just because people are dismayed at how long it's going to take to get money.
Yes.
And that's
but you say the county has to prepare the individual grant.
Well, we're going to make the applicants, I promise.
Okay.
We're not doing this for anybody. Just going to receive benefit.
Yeah. So the main point there being that the county probably won't expect to see an actual dollar flow into the county until late of 2017. That's the most likely situation.
We just finished this morning having a county commission meeting where I told the board we finished a round of what they call early restoration projects done by some in Franklin County. It's taken 5 years to get early restoration started. I mean, it's just mind-boggling about how complicated and torturous this process has been created.
Yes, torture would be a really good descriptive word there. But luckily, like Alan said, we've been doing it for some time now. Brian Griffith, our vice president, he was staffed at the Gulf Coast Ecosystem Restoration Council when the Restore Act was written. So he's been very intimately involved with this process ever since day one. And so all of us have. So we will definitely guide you as best as we can. On page 12, this just kind of gives you an idea of where the website is, where to go to. So once again, franklincountyrestore.com, written up here on the board as well. Yes, franklincountyrestore.com is where all of the information about this process will be posted. And you have a link to that on the main page as well. That pretty much concludes everything I had to give to you all tonight. We've got about 10 minutes or so left for questions, discussion, so I will see if anybody has any questions.
I do, because my brain is just fried.
Yes.
But I got to ask you one question. Okay, the 3.5, you said that's there now?
It is.
Okay, now year one, DP's year one, the 1.2?
That's correct.
Right. When does that actually go into effect?
The consent decree, this document agreement that all the parties have to sign, has not been signed yet, so they have to sign that first. And then in that document, it'll say when the first payment is going to come, but we think it's going to be in 17.
So it's very possible our year one really will represent $4.7 million, because we have 3.5
yes.
and the first year of VP. But we don't know that yet. It's possible that this whole thing falls apart and they haven't signed the decree yet.
Lawyers make some money during that.
Yeah. So, it's certainly possible that by the time we get all through that, not only do we have the transocean with $3.5 million, we have year one and maybe year two, so it's possible that we have, $5 million or so to deal with.
The
year one starts when the judge.
They haven't said yet when BP's first payment is going to be. But they think the consent decree will take about a year from July of this year. So they think it'll be finalized in July of next year. And then once it's finalized, then they think the first payment from BP will be in 2017. So that's conjecture at this point, but that's what we have to go on until it's signed.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
We have a little time to kill, but it's not a big audience. So if there are any questions from the audience what we've covered so far, or we're just here to try and get people to understand the process that that we're following that was set up by U.S. Treasury. We don't have that much flexibility. They say you get the public involved, prove the public's involved, prove that you have a basis for why you rank projects the way you are, and that's the process that you're going to help us go through.
So if there are no more questions or discussion from the board, we will turn it over to the audience. Yes, ma'am, and if you wouldn't mind identifying yourself for the record, that would be great.
I can't use your mic.
It actually doesn't work for tonight's meeting, so I don't think you need it.
Okay, good.
Well, it is working.
There you go.
If you just can you move around?
This this comes up?
Whatever. I can, no, you have to do the whole one.
Oh, the whole podium.
It's okay. It's all right. See, right.
There you go. Now everybody will be able to hear you.
We've done this before.
Thank you.
My name is Tamara Allen, and I'm the program manager for the Carabel Waterfront Partnership. And I heard the presentation that Allen made this morning to the county commission, and I heard you say that they were frowning on projects that required the purchase of land.
The NERDA projects, yeah, the one that I was talking about this morning, early restoration, there was almost no land acquisitions done in that program. We are not quite bound by that, being restored. We haven't talked about particular criteria, but land acquisition is an eligible activity, so it could be done, yes.
Okay. If you can tie it to one of the 11 eligible activities, then it can be eligible.
So if we're buying land for environmental restoration, yes, we can buy land.
Okay. Or for waterfront public access,
or
for example.
Waterfront public access, economic opportunity, mm-hmm. that kind of thing, if we can tie it back to that. Okay, I just was trying to get a better understanding.
Yeah, this morning I was talking about the state of Florida in their NERDA project did not do any, the following phase five did a little bit of land acquisition, but they really downplayed it. They were really, no, we want to see other benefits.
Okay,
other
thank you.
Yeah, Dan, yeah.
I'm Dan Tonsmeyer with Apalachicola Riverkeeper. Just a question, and it's because our heads get so full when you look at all three or five or seven pots of money. Could you say a little more about the general purpose that, I know it's environmental restoration and economic development. Can you say any more about how those things are viewed or defined?
So I don't know if it's a misconception or not, I guess you're going to explain it to us. There have been, I had understood that there was a percentage, caps, that you had to spend so much money in environmental restoration, so much money in economic development, so much money in infrastructure, so much money in tourism, but I don't think that's the case.
That there are certain pots where there are caps on infrastructure, for example, but in this particular pot, the direct component, the county has the final say, well, really Treasury has the final say, but on the percentages, if you choose to allocate certain percentages to certain categories up front, you could do that, and we'll talk about that at future meetings. Or you could say, let's just see what comes to us and see what the best projects are. And maybe they're comprehensive projects that address a couple of different things. But just to get a little bit more into what the eligible activities are for this specific pot, you have restoration and protection of natural resources, ecosystems, fisheries, marine and wildlife habitats, beaches, and coastal wetlands of the Gulf Coast region. And you are allowed to, by the way, as Alan said, you are allowed to say, we will only accept and approve projects that are in Franklin County. You are not obligated to approve any other projects outside of the county. Mitigation of damage to fish, wildlife, natural resources, and again, any combination of this, implementation of a federally approved marine plan, or fisheries monitoring, workforce development and job creation. That's another one that's in here. Improvements to state parks, infrastructure projects benefiting the economy or ecological resources, including port infrastructure. So you have infrastructure in here. Coastal flood protection and related infrastructure. We're seeing a couple of counties focus a lot of their efforts on flood protection. Just because of the floods that the Pensacola area had and some of this area had in April of 2014. Planning assistance and administrative costs. Those are some of the costs that Alan was saying would help to cover the county's cost of actually having to go through this whole process and put all this together. Promotion of tourism, including recreational fishing, and promotion of the consumption of seafood harvested from the Gulf Coast region. So it's a pretty broad array of eligible activities. Some folks like to say it would be harder to find a project that's not eligible for this money than it is to find ones that are. So it's it'll be an interesting process to kind of pare that down. So far, most of the counties have just said they haven't given any specific allocations. You know, some people, Escambia County for a while, tossed around 30% infrastructure, 30% economy, 30% environmental, and then 10% tourism, but they ultimately decided they weren't going to do that.
One of the things that's not, well, it is sort of here. What Treasury doesn't want to see, and I hopefully we wouldn't want to promote it, is where a community takes an opportunity to supplant, take some of this money and use it for some of their existing programs they got going on now. You know, we couldn't take this money and subsidize the sheriff's department as an example. You know, it just isn't going to apply. Or in case the school system, you know, the school system may have programs. If they have programs they want to see done, they need to be associated with creative jobs and training for certain jobs. So that we can't use it for, you know, again, supplementing, you know, programs that are already.
Supplement the general fund.
Yes.
Okay. So is that list you were reading off, is that on the website that you?
I'm sure it will be.
You know, this whole presentation, I'm sorry I didn't bring enough copies for everybody, but this will be posted on this website as of tomorrow at the latest, so you'll have the list on there. You'll see the meeting date list, you'll see December 15th, and next to it will say presentation. If you open that, it'll have this on it. But Treasury, this is all in the Restore Act, so on Treasury's website, treasury.gov/restore, it's also listed on their website as well.
And so these guys can take that criterion, sort of say you get 2 points for this one. I mean, is that the ranking kind of thing you're talking about?
Exactly. We get a little bit more specific because these categories are really, really broad, and these are just sort of general broad eligibility categories. So we'll get a lot more drilled down. I mean, we'll get as far as, you know, seagrass restoration, oyster protection, water quality, you know, stormwater runoff, flooding. We'll get a little bit more specific than this. So this one has 11, a list of 11. Typically, the ones we have been doing for other counties have about 30 to 40 criteria. But they all fall within one of these categories. So we've been having about 4 to 5 criteria per category.
So as an example,
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, my name's Robin Vroegop. I'm a citizen, and I also am involved in the ecotourism industry. So there's no lack of need in this county. But my question was, could you go into a little more detail about, because the next two meetings I heard are needs assessment. Mm-hmm. So what are you really looking for in a needs assessment?
Yeah, and that's a really good question. More or less what next meeting's discussion will be about is imagine if, you know, somebody that has never been to this county came with you with $25 million in free money and said, what is the most critical issue or issues affecting this county? What do you think this money could go towards that would help at least start to stem some of those issues? And that's really the kind of answers we're looking to get. And, you know, different people have different ideas. And if you all want to add some, do you want to add some, Paul?
Yeah, thanks.
Sure, go ahead.
One of E&E's objectives will be reviewing existing plans and documents that are out there. So when we come back to you looking for your needs assessment, there won't be like a blank slate for you to come up with what you think will be important, although I know you have some ideas for Franklin County. But we'll be reviewing other documents, and I'm sure there's a mechanism to try to get documents that you may be aware of to us so that we've been assembling them for the last month or so. We'll start doing that in earnest this month. And we don't know everything that's about the county, so if there are documents out there, Alan and others, that you think are going to be important to this process, you may want to find a way to get them on the
right, because one of the criteria I believe Treasury uses is best available data.
Exactly.
Yes. So you know, we just can't say using that we're going to rebuild this marsh grass here, and you know, we need to say how we're going to do it. You know, we can't. You know, they're not interested in innovating. You know, new ways of doing things. They say, you know, how are you going to do it, and are you following some established criteria that shows it's going to work?
Right, yeah. And that'll help. Help you all, it helps us, and it's obviously going to help Treasury to see a justification. And those documents could be a broad range from a wildlife protection plan or a plan for the river versus a capital improvement plan for McCullough County or the city of Apalachicola or Carabel. Those are the type of plans that we're looking for, so we're looking at existing data and information to try to help you develop what the needs assessments are.
Yeah, it won't be a blank slate. Like I said, we definitely want to get your ideas and input and everybody else here as well and the folks that attend the meeting, but we won't just come to you and say, tell us what to do. We'll have a list to start from, and you guys can kind of scratch and delete and add.
Yeah, an example of cities, I use cities because they're you know, you all are municipalities that have a history of working for the people, you know, and some of those are really infrastructure based. So I fully expect the cities, most cities, to come back and say, okay, these are lists of infrastructure projects that we, you know, have. We know are a problem for our community, and we need some assistance in trying to get those done. And you know, I fully expect that, and that's what, yeah. What you're here for.
But so, I got a 5-year stonework.
Yeah, perfect example.
Exactly.
And I'm running for years.
Right.
Exactly. So the plans already exist.
Right.
Exactly. It's on the capital improvements plan, our capital improvements plan, it still can qualify.
Absolutely.
To come here.
That's a perfect example.
I even I could drop that off tonight if we let me.
But the real challenge is,
the next meeting?
Is to say not only do we have this problem, but we also have some money leveraging. We don't have enough. So
right,
that's,
right.
That's
yes,
the real.
It's to kind of fill the gaps.
I got that.
And now, if the are you wanting these projects, or is that maybe this committee's job to decide? Part of the criteria would be if they're engineered already. If you have the engineered plans already. That might make the project.
Yes, that's going to be part of the criteria you score higher, right? If you're ready to go, a word that I hate using because it really wasn't very applicable, is shovel ready.
We hate that word too.
We hate it because in a small community, and I fully expect it's the cities as well as any non-governmental, you don't have shovel ready because you didn't never have enough money to hire the consultants to develop the plan to begin with.
Absolutely.
So you may have some general issues.
Right.
But we have this terrible problem the county did with some of the other federal acts. You know, we couldn't get access to money because we didn't have the money to pay the engineers to design the project. So that's the same issue. We fully expect that to be an
and that actually can be considered your match. If, for example, your organization, your municipality, had already expended the funds to get engineering and design completed, and you're looking for money for construction, whatever the value that you already paid for that engineering and design can be considered a match.
Exactly.
That's something to keep in mind. One other point, and I think it's important, and you're sort of getting an idea of the playbook here at your very first meeting, and this will be a long process, so it's best to figure it out as we go and get it right, because we've only got one shot at this. But that is that you may have a project that may have multiple phases and multiple opportunities for funding. You may consider a large project, and you don't have to get the one bite at the apple. You can take nibbles to get that whole apple. And so you may have a large project that's divided up into phases, so to speak. And you can approach it that way as well.
Yeah, like solar for you.
That may go
you
on.
You've got a separate solar that's, you know, servicing the worst, you know, the park doesn't do that. Right.
The plan that Dr. McCarthy put together was a while back.
Yeah, I mean, I remember. I know he worked on some stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'd definitely like to get a copy of that if possible. Other public comments? Did that answer your question, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Jessica?
I just wanted to say hi to the committee. So my name is Jessica Kelsch, and I'm with the National Wildlife Federation, and we have a really diverse membership, everything from, you know, sportsmen, the hook and bullet guys, to the bunny huggers, and, you know, wildlife watchers and gardeners. So, I mean, the whole gambit. Ranger Rec magazine, maybe some of you guys grew up reading Ranger Rec magazine. And I've been actually kind of tracking these various BP oil spill monies in all 23 of the Gulf counties, or most of the 23 of the Gulf counties, and these various processes. And so I've seen all these guys at, you know, plenty of meetings. But anyhow, really excited that you guys are kind of getting going. The whole Apalachicola River region is, I know I don't need to tell you this, but it is of huge significance to the Gulf of Mexico. And like I said, we're a national organization with a Gulf program, and this is one of those areas that we really are hoping lots of good stuff comes out of, because like I said, you have such an important contribution to the Gulf ecosystem as a whole. So I just really want to encourage you to think big. A lot of the other funding sources have already been making investments in the region. You know, the Gulf Coast Ecosystem Council, also known as POT 2, that just last week, they finalized a plan to do a bunch of projects in the area to kind of help improve the watershed. And, you know, you guys have the opportunity to make recommendations to build on that. As you heard, there's this Triumph Gulf Coast and potentially some economic money. I mean, all these other funding sources, as Alan said, they are really competitive, but you have the opportunity to make a statement with the projects you select to put you in a better position to be more competitive for some of those other funds. So anyhow, I think it's really exciting. I hope that you're all excited to be on this committee because you have the opportunity to make a significant contribution to your area. So thanks.
Thank you. One of the things that I said we really focus on restore, but it's certainly possible that the Triumph money, because we've already been told by the people running the Triumph money, there's going to be, unless the legislature messes with it, which they certainly have the ability and the standing to do so here in March, but if they don't, some $350 million will come out of a separate settlement the state of Florida got to the Triumph Fund reserved for the 8 impacted counties. And we're one of those 8 counties. And what Triumph people have already told us is, not just Franklin County, but all counties, do not consider Triumph to be a sole source funder. You know, we ought to be not the first money, but the last money. So if you go to Triumph, and they're really only for economic development, they're not for environmental restoration. They are here to create a new type of North Florida. But they certainly would look very favorable to projects that have other funding. They told us that. In fact, if we come to them or anything in Franklin County was saying, we want some Triumph fund, they will not approve it unless there's matching funds. And it may be that Restore is some of that matching money. Because you know there's $350 million set aside among 8 counties and would love to get some of that money. But they've already told us, you better come with some money, otherwise you're not going to get funded. And that's only for environmental or economic restoration. Mm-hmm.
And I think they even go one step further. I think they not only require a one-to-one match in the legislation, it specifies that at least part of the match has to be from a private enterprise.
Okay.
Right. So, but they still require a match, and as I understand it, they're the criteria review, more or less, the higher the match you have, the more points you're going to get. So if there's money coming from the county or the city in addition to the private enterprise, then the more the merrier.
Yes, the state has that money?
Yes.
The state sued BP separately in a $2 billion settlement, and the state got that money. And the legislature, before they knew how much money was involved, said, state of Florida, that's great. You sue them, and whatever you get, you can give those 8 counties. When the number turned out to be $2 billion, then the legislature was like, we didn't really mean that much money. And so it's very possible that not all of that money would be reserved for the panhandle. Initially, it was left that way, honest, that, whatever the state of Florida gets, it'll go to the panhandle as, because they agreed on the terms before the amount of money was known. And so now the amount of money is $2 billion. So actually, 75% of $2 billion, or $1.5 billion, is reserved for the 8 impacted counties. And I feel fairly sure that the first payment of that, which is $350 million, the legislature will let go of the 8 counties. I'm not sure that the rest will follow. I just think that's so much they're going to argue that the other needs are
taken. It's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And those are for regional economic projects.
It's for transformational economic development, sort of transformational in nature. So they want big things to happen. And I can see Orlando saying, we can have a big thing happen here,
like bringing a new industry to town or really, really improving the existing industry or something like that. If you brought another, maybe, for example, a seafood processor that helped expand the ones that were already here and created a bunch of jobs, for example, something like that.
So, you may have already mentioned it, but a good example of that is the Gulf Consortium, which is considered top three.
Yeah, top three.
Initially, the 23 counties that make up the consortium, initially with their rules, the 8 disproportionately affected counties were going to get 75% of that pot. Restore Act money, they have internally re-decided that distribution would be equal among the 23 counties. So that's an example, sort of like what Mr. Pierce just mentioned, that the rules can change on that allocation depending on the entity that's working in. And with the Triumph Gulf Coast, that was created by the legislature. There's a sort of a rule in Tallahassee, the legislature can give it, they can take it away. So
basically, in layman's terms, you got to bring money to get your money.
Yes. Right now, that'll be the case, yeah. You're familiar.
Okay, I'm going to belabor it. This is great. You all are smart guys, women, and I don't want to let you go sleepy here. So, unless there's any other questions, we'll call it night. And we'll let you notice it'll be at least January, if not a bit later, before we have a second meeting. If you have any questions, call me, or I'm sure Stella's numbers are somewhere.
My contact information is definitely on this sheet right here. And if you don't want to carry this around, I have some cards as well.